Geoengineering poses serious risks for the environment as well. Geoengineering techniques may alter precipitation patterns, produce droughts, increase acid rainfall. Aerosol particles sprayed into the atmosphere could accelerate ozone depletion or reduce the total sunlight that reaches the Earth's surface, impact agricultural production, or reduce solar power production. Sulfate injection into the atmosphere could increase acid deposition in the ocean, possibly beyond biological thresholds. Geoengineering may pose unknown stresses on ecosystems and biodiversity. Now, some of these proposed techniques are not easily reversible if the effects are not what were intended. As Newton said, what goes up must come down. Any particulates in the air will eventually fall to the ground, on our homes, our businesses, the land, the water, our persons. Farmland covers about 10% of this state. Aquaculture is an important part of the state economy. We are not aware of anyone that has considered, much less studied, the impact of geoengineering on the ocean state's oyster harvest, for example. The economic impact of geoengineering experiments gone awry is completely unknown. The consequences of deliberately manipulating the climate and the environment are not completely understood. More research and experimentation is underway, and absent legislation or some form of public oversight to monitor and control experimentation, private actors may be free to engage in reckless behavior in the name of science or financial gain. And I'll give you an example. In 2012, an American citizen conducted a geoengineering experiment in ocean fertilization off the west coast of Canada by dumping 100 tons of iron sulfate into the Pacific Ocean in an effort to trigger a plankton boom and promote salmon restoration. Now, state laws should prohibit this type of activity without authorization, but current laws do not necessarily prevent these activities. It's not clear that geoengineering is prohibited, even regulated by existing federal and state environmental laws. House Bill 611 will guard against careless experimentation and deployment of any such activity and its concomitant risks. House Bill 611 proposes a sensible method for tracking and assessing the danger and efficacy of any geoengineering activity in the state and for monitoring that activity and its impacts. In that regard, House Bill 611 is entirely consistent with this state's environmental policies. This state has vowed to protect air, water, land, and natural resources located within the state from pollution, impairment, and destruction. House Bill 611 upholds this state's commitment to those policies. Additionally, Bill 611 is a modest bill. It only requires that anyone proposing to deploy geoengineering technology in the state apply for a license. And by disclosing the proposed project, its scope and methods, chemical substances being employed, and the qualifications of participants, that's not asking a lot in terms of regulation. It promotes transparency by providing the public with online access to that information and an opportunity to participate in the decision-making process through the hearing. It promotes efficacy by engaging the state's leading experts in environment, health, and agriculture, natural resources, and emergency management to weigh in on the potential impacts of the proposed activity. House Bill 611 is not a blanket prohibition on geoengineering, though some might argue it should be. But it is a sensible approach to a new technology. The deliberate manipulation of the Earth's atmosphere and climate is real. It is imminent. It raises a host of scientific, political, ethical, and moral concerns. And in light of these concerns, Rhode Island is poised to meet that challenge today and lead on this issue for the sake of its citizens and its environment.
Record droughts, and then all of a sudden, it's been raining cats and dogs. What's happening?
Well, it's important to understand, George, that when the climate engineers control the spigot, they can turn it on and off as they wish. And for those that don't believe this can be done on this kind of a scale, they simply haven't done their research. When you fill the atmosphere with particulates, you affect the hydrological cycle dramatically. So we can speculate as to the agenda of why the spigot's been turned on in California, but the overall agenda, again, is much, much larger. If you look at our society and all the things people are concerned about, I would ask this. If we have powers around the world radically derailing Earth's life support systems, climate, life support systems, atmosphere, and if they damage that beyond the planet's ability to support life, will anything else matter at that point? And I would argue, obviously not. So in the case of California, it's much bigger than just California. We have things happening in both polar zones right now that are not being reported, incredibly radical. In fact, frontline data looks like we may have an ice-free Arctic at the end of this year or next. That's about 100 years ahead of schedule. And I know people are ranting coming ice age, global cooling. I would challenge, I do challenge anyone, and this is not about Al Gore and carbon credits, both of which are shams. I would challenge anyone to look at the frontline data, look at the temperatures we're seeing. George, did you happen to notice that 2 weeks ago in the middle of winter, Texas hit 107 degrees?
Well, I know. It's crazy. St. Louis, it's been 70 almost all of February. It's crazy.
Exactly. The only reason we're having these radical cool downs because we had about a dozen instances of record high temperature to snow in less than 24 hours in the U.S. in the last 2 weeks. That's because they're chemically ice nucleating wherever they have enough moisture to do so. So they're fire hosing moisture in from the west right now.